All right. Hi. Hi, Rock Church family. How are you? Merry Christmas. Oh, wow. That was sad. Merry Christmas. I'm stressed out. It's been a long day. I've gone out shopping. Is that how you're feeling? Is everybody done with their shopping yet? Is somebody not done with your shopping? Oh my goodness, you guys, so totally rock you came to church instead of shopping. So we just love you. You're the best. And, you know, Christmas can be crazy. It can become this, like, stressful, like, pain in the side. It could really put a damper on things. And I believe us as Christians, we carry the heart of Christmas. And we know the true meaning behind Christmas. Now, I've been watching all the Hallmark movies, and honestly, Christmas has nothing to do with Santa and people falling in love. You know, the storyline is you get the girl, guy loses girl, guy gets girl back. Okay, every time I watch the show, Dan tells me that and it ruins the movie for me. But that is not what Christmas is about. Christmas is about Jesus. Christmas is about Jesus coming to this earth and being born in a manger, all so that we can have life. And I just think it's quite amazing that he could have picked anywhere to be born. He could have been born in a palace. He could have been born, you know, he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He's the one who created the universe. He formed it. He named it. He knows every animal. He knows every hair on our heads. But yet he chose to come. He chose to be in a manger. He chose all of it so that everything could play out in the scarlet cord. And as you have been in the services, if you weren't here this weekend, get the message also from this weekend, because it will explain the scarlet cord and the beautiful story of Jesus throughout time. But I believe that we here, Rock Church and World Outreach Center, we are here to carry on the scarlet cord. We are here to carry on the vision and the story and the gospel to a dying generation, to people who need Jesus. And so I believe that we have a big piece in Christmas, and you know, Christmas isn't about the shopping, and it's not about if we get the meal right, or if, you know, so-and-so's macaroni and cheese is better than somebody else's macaroni and cheese, and Dr. B's laughing because Gina and her have a little competition going on, but I asked some of my friends to come up and to, let's talk about Christmas. So would you guys like to have a panel tonight? Just something a little different than a message. We're going to talk about Christmas. And each one of them are just so unique and so wonderful. And so I'll start at the end of the table and I'll introduce you to some of our pastors and our reverends, okay? This is Reverend Teresa. We just love Reverend Teresa. She is one of our Bible college professors, and she has just been such a blessing to us in the women's ministry. She, like, makes the women's ministry tick, and she is just such an asset to the kingdom and to the house of God. If you ever have an issue, if you talk to her about the Word of God, you're going to get it. She's going to, like, pour it out on you. You're going to get filled up. You're going to be changed. You will never walk away from a conversation with Teresa normal. And the same. You will walk away feeling filled up. I'm filled. I'm ready to go. I can do what it is that God's asked me to do. And so, anyways, that's Teresa. Now, Teresa is single. So if you are in here, I will be taking applications. But we are very picky, right, Pastor Luke, about who Teresa talks to. All right. So you have to go through all of us. So that is Reverend Teresa, so she's going to give us some perspective tonight on what her world is like and what she's learned over the years and how she deals with stress of Christmas, how family goes, how being single in the Christmas time is, and what the things that tips that she could give you. Pastor Joel, I mean, what do we say? You're the, like, crazy one. Pastor Joel and Pastor Joanna, they're just such a blessing to us. If you have been through Breaking Free, how many of you have gone through Breaking Free? Woohoo! Listen, this is a church that just loves Jesus to life. We are all been redeemed from something. We have all been saved from something. I call us the church of the X's. We are X everything around here, but because Jesus has filled us, equipped us, and changed us. And so I know that Pastor Joel, he prays that in. He prays over you. He speaks over you. When Joel and Joanna speak, there's wisdom that pours out. They have a passion for the things of God. Not only that, but he's an incredible father, and he's an incredible husband. He has, how many kids do you have? You have, like, 5 kids, and he has just nurtured, and he's had rough times, he's had good times, he's had We're going to talk about family tonight. We're going to talk about Jesus tonight. We're going to be real with you. We're going to share our lives so you guys know that everybody goes through it, but we have an awesome God who brings us through the hard times and the Christmas season. So this is Pastor Joelle, and this is Reverend Dr. Vanessa Reynolds. She has so many, like, names in front of her name. She is a friend. She is a confidant. I can go to her with something, and I know that she will never lie to me. She will be honest with me, and I so love that about her. But then when she preaches, man, women in the women's ministry, she gives us a word, and we're like, whoa. And now she pours the word of God out on you, and you just begin to drink it in, and she will just give you scripture after scripture. She knows her word. It comes up in, out of her. And so she is a mom of 5 children as well. And Dr. Vanessa has children in every season of life. So she has the adult who has their own family and their own child. Then she has the college-age child that she's believing and loving and getting them through the adult teen. I call it the junior high of adulthood. That's what I call that. And then she has the teenagers. And then she has the young kids, like the 7 and 5 years old, right? 8 and 10. Oh, my gosh. They did grow up fast. 8 and 10. So she has her hands full. She's a doctor. She's a reverend on staff. She helps us. So she is going to pour into us this week. And then last but not least, my amazing, wonderful brother, Pastor Luke. Woohoo! Wow, Luke. You got like a cheering crowd over here. All right. I feel like I'm like an announcer, and today Pastor Luke is going to, no, just kidding. Pastor Luke is going to speak into our lives, and he is going to talk about having a young family and the craziness of Christmas season, and how do we get through that? How do we love our family, our extended family, but also keep family traditions and begin new things in our lives? So Pastor Luke is going to pour into us as well. So before we get started, can we pray? All right. Well, dear Father God, we love you. We thank you for today, God. We thank you for tonight. Lord, we ask that you would just speak through us. I pray that every person sitting in this room, Lord, would receive something from you tonight, God, that there'd be a nugget that they run home with and that would change their perspective, their life, and their vision, God. And I pray, God, that your name would be shined so bright in our homes this holiday season, God, this Christmas season this week, God, that you would just be so big in the hearts of every person that walks through the doors of our homes. And Lord, we thank you for that. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Okay, the way this is going to work, Teresa, I will start with you. Okay, so let's see here. Teresa, how do you deal with the holidays as a single person?
All right.
Go for it, girl.
Yeah. So I think some of the things that are important that I've learned to deal with, first of all, recognizing in our world what we do have. I think a lot of times, if we're single and we're not living in the fullness of what God has given us as single adults, one of the things that slows us down is not realizing what we do have, what God has given us, what is in front of us, who are the people that are in our lives. A lot of the negative experiences that one can have as a single, and that I would say that I didn't still experience until about 10 years ago, was focusing on what don't I have? What am I missing? Where is my husband? Where are my children? Where are those pieces that you see in all of the movies and, you know, the ideal little picture? And that's not happening in my world. So you can focus on that, or you can stop. And this is what I had to do. I had to come to a place where I let the Lord say, what do you have? What have I given you? Begin to use that. Begin to invest in that. Begin to see value in that. So for me, that was my family and my sisters and the friends that surrounded me. Begin to see, these are God's gifts to me. What am I doing with these relationships? And I think that's true for all of us, that we have to learn to connect to what is in our life. That would be my first thing, is see what God has given you and connect with that. Place value on that. Don't place the value on what you're missing, what you think you're lacking, but know that God loves you and he has placed things in your life that you probably don't see if you're living in misery or if you feel like you're living in lack and you're missing out, because he is more than enough, and he's not going to create a world around us where we don't have what we need. God has given us everything that we need, the word says, for life and godliness. And if we believe him, then we can trust him and begin to invest in what's in our world. So that's what I began to do. I began to do that maybe 12 years ago, and just began to invest and see the value in my world and connect with those people that were there. And then once I began to connect with them, I learned to invest. You know, the Christmas is just a season of giving, right? We talk about it's a season of giving. That's just another way of investing. Giving, you're investing. Because in the kingdom, I mean, nothing's wasted, right? If you think about your giving as an investment, you're sowing into God's promises, right? You're sowing into what the Word of God tells us, that seed time and harvest will never fail. So as long as I go planting seed, no matter where I go, that God is going to reap a harvest from that. And so what I began to do in my family was open my home and say, let's do Christmas here. Let's make a space for Christmas in my world. So in my world, all of my family comes over for Christmas. So starting tomorrow after church service here, there'll be 30 to 40 people landing at my house tomorrow night. And after church service for a huge dinner. And up until this year, half of them would spend the night, wake up in the morning, we do Christmas breakfast, and then 5 o'clock Christmas Day, we do Christmas dinner. And so I would actually host my family. Instead of thinking, you know, who's going to do something for me, you just put your hands to work. God, what do I have? Okay, I have space in my world. I have a home that's a huge living room. All of these people can fit, and everybody who's willing, you know, and wants to can come and be a part of it. So we've created a great family tradition that my niece and nephews love. And I get to have the joy of having kids there, of having family there, you know, and it's an amazing experience. But what it really is tapping into the kingdom principles, right? Law of use. You know, Matthew 25 in the parable of the talents, God tells us that when we use what we have, it's going to be increased, right? He says, take from the one who doesn't have, who didn't use the talent that God gave him, and give to the one who has, the one who multiplied. And that's because whatever that particular servant had in his hand, the talents that God had given them, he began to use them. So my encouragement is to see who's in your world and see what you do have, because we all have something. And, you know, Christmas is tomorrow's Christmas Eve. Christmas Day is just 2 days away. And you might be sitting there saying, well, I don't have time to change my whole world, Teresa, but I have Christmas right around the corner. But you have something. Maybe you can bake cookies in your home. Maybe you can deliver them to neighbors or friends on Christmas Day. Don't sit and sulk if you're alone. Find out what you have and invest. Maybe you can get on your laptop and go to people's Facebook pages and leave notes of encouragement and Merry Christmas and give to them. You know, there's always something we can do if you're willing to see it and tap in and say, Lord, what do I have and how can you help me to give it? And in turn, you're sowing into your own life and it's going to reap a harvest of joy, blessing, and relationships.
I told you, she's amazing, isn't she? And I have reaped from her investment. She is just a breathtaking, beautiful picture of Jesus. So thank you for that, Teresa. Okay, Pastor Joel, let me see what I have for you. Okay, traditionally, women are the ones that like decorate and bake, and they get all excited for Christmas. Now, traditionally, now I know a lot of men that are not like this, so I'm just saying not all men are like this, but a lot of them are. What is it that is in a man's role, and what type of stress do men carry during Christmas season? If it's not the baking, the shopping, the keeping Christmas alive in the home, Dan was telling me that men have other stresses. Can you share with me what the stresses are that men carry during the Christmas season?
You know, reading this question to my wife, who's not here because she's a little under the weather, her first response was, you don't cook. And I'm like, okay, well, you know, there it is. She's throwing me under the bus already and running me over.
If she wasn't sick, she would have been here.
I don't do those things. It's not like I shouldn't, but I just don't. But I do add my piece. What's my piece? I put up the lights. I put on the music. I eat all the tamales and cookies.
Somebody's got to do it.
I'm ready. Somebody's have to do it. But I think for me, Pastor Jessica, I think something happened to us a long time ago when we stacked up the Christmas tree, and one of the girls or one of our children had like 30 dolls in Christmas. Wow. And we said to ourselves, this is just madness. This is not the right way to do it. What are we birthing into our children? What kind of idea and mindset are they going to carry when they get old? I picture the story of that little kid that didn't get what he want and threw the present at the mother. And I'm thinking, you know, this is just disappointment. So for us, it's a tradition of a true spirit of Christmas. And true spirit of Christmas to us is, it's about Jesus and the celebration of who he is. And if my home is filled with Jesus and I don't have any money, it's going to be okay. If my home is filled with Jesus and I don't have a tree, it's going to be all right. If my home has Jesus and it's just beans and rice and Jesus Christ, it's going to be perfect. Because it's not about the stuff. It's about what God represents to us and what I'm transferring to my generation, the little ones, now older ones that are looking at us. You know, Matthew 2:2 said that the wise men came to worship him. And Pastor Dan said it earlier that, you know, wise men still worship him. I say this, obedient men still honor and worship and serve him. And if you're willing to do what God wants you to do to change your world, you'll do the little things that matter. What matters? Micah 8 says this, that God wants this from his people. He requires justice and mercy, loving kindness and humility, and walking in obedience with our God. You want to bless your family this Christmas to that in-law that you don't like? Give them the gift of forgiveness. Give them the gift of mercy. Give them the gift that Jesus gave you. If we're all about Jesus, then serve them. Help them. Be with them. And change their oil. Do something that's significant. Part of what the Lord did with us, he gave us a gift, the rock, with this shooting that happened just a few weeks ago. Here's the gift that we're able to display to this community. With no strings attached, we'll welcome you in and love you. With no demand, with on-the-spot reaction, we opened up our doors and loved those that were hurting, traumatized, bleeding inside and out. And we said to them, this church is about what Jesus wants, and that's the spirit of Christmas. This is the spirit of Christmas, that God wants us to do what Isaiah says in fasting, to break the bonds and the yokes. I'm telling you, there are department stores that are open 24/7 till Christmas. That's not the spirit of Christmas. I'm not against those department stores. If you want to go in your PJs with your hair all frazzled at 3 in the morning and shop, be my guest. I'm not against the department stores. I'm against what it does to us inside. If I got no gift, I have the best gift, and that's Jesus in my heart and in my family. And I pray to God that the traditions that we're doing, and we do traditions, that they will continue to transfer to our children, and our children will love God, do mercy, walk humbly, and obey Jesus. That's really the spirit that's overtaken us. To answer your question, we just jump in. I'm a part of it. I don't have to put on my man bun and start kneading the dough. Luke could do that. Here's what I have to do. Here's what I challenge you men to do. Don't run and hide.
Yeah, that's good. That's nice.
Don't go and just hide out. My daughters and my sons, they all pull me at the table. Dad, stay. Be a part of it. I don't care if it's just conversation. Interact. They want not an absent father. They want a present father. And if you want to give them something, give them you, and they will appreciate it. That's what has happened to us.
Wow, I love that. Good job, Pastor Joel. Okay, Dr. Vanessa, Dr. Reverend Vanessa. I never know what to call you. Okay, you have 5 children, and all of them are in different seasons of life. So how do you keep unity and peace this Christmas season with all these different kids, all these different lives? How do you, as mama, keep everybody together? How do you do that?
Okay, well, unity, I do have my youngest is 8, and my oldest is 28. So, you know, things have changed over the years. But I think that it can't start at Christmas. And so we make an effort to, once a week, on Sundays, we always eat together. Whatever we do, we catch up on each other's lives, and we eat together. On Mondays, we have Bible study in our home with just the family. And so it can't just be, you know, yes, it's going to be awkward to be united if you just do it once a year, right? So in demonstrating the love of Christ, we need to every day, just like, you know, every day is our Sabbath, every day needs to be a celebration of what Christ has done for us. Every day we need to rejoice because he came, because this scarlet cord is woven through every element of our lives, and we need to remind each other of that. So, but practically speaking, you know, those are the things we do. We eat together, we pray together, and we fellowship together. And when you talk about unity, you talk about, you know, caring about each other's lives. And I think one thing that I have stressed since the kids were little is caring about each other. So if somebody has a soccer game, we come out in force. I remember there was a program at the school, and one of the teachers was like, is this the entire family? And it just so happened that, you know, all the godparents and all the grandparents could come that night, and our immediate family is like 12 people. And so the kids had like 20 people there. It was almost embarrassing, you know. But we do support each other throughout the year in all the little events. And I think that with your children, that builds, you know, self-confidence and self-esteem. And it keeps the family together so that by Christmas time, unity is just a piece of cake. There's one verse I wanted to share that I had written down, and sometimes when your extended family comes around, you know, it can be stressful at Christmas because not everybody believes what you believe and does the things that you do. I know when my son got married, you know, we gave up our Christmas day. It wasn't important which day it was because, you know, nobody knows if it's the 25th of December, right? We just celebrate Jesus on that day. So Amanda's family celebrates Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, and we usually pick another day. So we're celebrating Christmas on the 27th. So you have to be willing to, just for sake of unity, and have everybody together, not have your kids just dash into this parent's house and not having a good time because they got to run to this parent's house and run over here, run over there, think about that, and we changed our Christmas, you know, and it, for us, that worked. I don't know if it will work for everybody, but here's my verse that to leave you with, and it is Ephesians 4, verse 2, always be humble and gentle, be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. And I think that's the verse that you have to keep in mind as you're trying to keep peace in the family. You know, we don't let little things bother us. You're trying to just demonstrate the love of Christ. And if you're with family that, you know, is not saved and they're doing things that you don't enjoy doing or it starts to get rowdy, usually at the beginning things are fine. And then you know your time, you pick your time to leave, you know. You fellowship with them. And if things start getting out of hand later, you know, then you just say, okay, it was wonderful seeing you guys, and you head on out. That's how we do it.
That's good. That is really good. Well, that's going to set me up for what I'm going to ask Pastor Luke here. Pastor Luke, how does a young family with little kids, okay, deal with going to multiple family Christmas events?
Well, I think that, you know, there's not a clear-cut answer to that. I think every person in every situation is going to be different. And to give background to where my answer comes from, it's a lot simpler, like when Dr. V said, when you have a flexible family, when, you know, they're saying, hey, listen, you know what, it's not a big deal. Like, the day, the actual day, no big deal. Like, we'll celebrate this time and we'll celebrate that time. Obviously, that would be the more convenient as well as the best way to handle that, with especially with a smaller family, just so that the kids can process what they have. But sometimes, you know, especially like in my end, you know, I come from the Cobras, and they're not a weak-willed family. So on the other end of the spectrum, my wife, her family's very close-knit, and neither are they. So, you know, where we come from, we kind of come from the background of which neither family really is willing to give up that day or any of those days, you know, whether it be Thanksgiving or Christmas or Easter Sunday or... So we've always had to deal with kind of, you know, the jumping back and forth between families. With two young college-age, you know, lovers, no big deal, whatever. But then you start throwing kids into the mix of it. And it does become difficult. It does become arduous. It becomes a chore. And I think one of the things to realize and to recognize more so than anything is that it's taxing on everybody involved. It's not just you, you know. I mean, for me, it's so easy for me to just get, you know, real upset and get real, like, you know, kind of getting a tiff about it and just, I want my own day and, you know, this and that. But it's taxing not just on me. It's taxing on my wife. It's taxing on my kids. It's taxing on my in-laws, on my wife's family. It's taxing on my family. All parties involved are feeling the tension of that because they all want something. And everybody's, we're trying to appease, you know, they want you for your family, and they want you for your family, and the kids want their cousins, and they want grandma's presents, and whatever, everybody wants something, so there's a reason that you're doing what you're doing, and it's taxing on everybody. So I think the first thing to do, you know, they say that, like, the first step of recognizing that you have a problem is recognizing or admitting that you have a problem. And I think that's kind of one of the first steps towards dealing with or finding a solution that works is to recognize that tension and that everybody involved is feeling that. It's not just you. It's not just, you know, your kids. Everybody involved in a multifamily or a split family, because ultimately, small children or not, you know, the majority of Americans come from split families or, you know, blended families, you know, families that are involved in divorces or splits, or, you know, maybe there's a move and so there's a family member over here and a family member over there, whatever it might be. You know, holidays are becoming increasingly more stressful because of the burden placed on, you know, spending time on those particular days. And I think the first thing you can do is just recognize, listen, you know, the day is going to be stressful. When you've got little kids, every day is stressful. You know what I mean? Like, when you have a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old, every day is stressful. They're like, every moment is stressful. But at the same time, when you can begin to realize, you know what, it's going to be a stressful day, then that gives you the freedom to begin to realize and begin to process what you're walking into instead of having this expectation. Because I think what happens when you look at Christmas, everybody wants It's a Wonderful Life. Everybody wants the Bing Crosby, I'll Be Home for Christmas, or I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. Everybody wants the Hallmark Channel Christmas, you know, where like everything comes together in the perfect moment and there's the Yule log and it's and chestnuts are roasting on an open fire, whatever that means. But life doesn't happen like that. That's why we watch the movies, because if life happened like that, we wouldn't need to watch the movies and say, I want life to happen like that, because it doesn't happen like that. So the realization is that life doesn't look like the Hallmark Channel is, I think, the first step to stepping into a realistic expectation of what the holiday is when you're sharing a family, especially with little children. So recognize that everybody's involved in this. Tension will never go away. Think about it for a moment. There will never be tension. As humans, we want to get out of tension. I'm as confrontational avoider as possible. Like, family fight, I'm like, I'm going to just creep, you know, well, because I have a tendency to stir the pot, so I just know I got to get out of here. But you can't remove tension. It's always going to be a part of that because people are involved. And where people are involved, there's always going to be tension. Whether it might be, you know, you go to the family or you go to over here or you go over there, whatever it might be. And while you're there, it's perfect and everything's wonderful and it went exactly how you planned. There's still going to be tension. It's going to be tension of when you have to leave and the kid doesn't want to go, or you don't want to go, or you want to go and they don't want to. Whatever it might be, there's still going to be tension in that. And to realize that, you can't remove tension out of the holiday, but when you realize that, you know what, there's going to be a little bit of tension, then what you can do is begin to say, how can I make the best of what's happening? Because ultimately, that's what it comes down to, is what can I do to make the best for this? You know, of course it's stressful. Of course, I would rather, you know, for us, I would rather sleep in, or I would rather have a moment of, like, no chaos and just my family, you know, because the way our Christmas has gone since we've had kids and even before that is, it's just like you wake up and you're going and you're going and you're going and you're going until about 10:30 at night you come home and that's Christmas. Like, you're just out. And it's real easy, like Teresa said, when you're single or when you're alone, to look at what you don't have. Man, I don't have a peaceful Christmas. I don't have a quiet Christmas. I don't have chestnuts roasting on the open fire, whatever that is. But at the same time, I can say, you know what can I do to make the best of this? You know, and I think the best thing I can do and the best thing I can say for that is, with that tension and with that frustration that comes with tension and with that frustration that comes with expectations oftentimes not met on these holidays, the best thing I can say, the thing that I've learned from my own self is to apply the golden rule. And Jesus talked about it. You know, we call it the golden rule in Luke 6 chapter. Jesus says, what you want done to you, do to everybody else. And, you know, I found myself for a season there, you know, when I would go to family's house and when I go to my family's house, because I was upset with the tension, I would just be the one that nobody wanted to be around. I'd sit on the couch and just not want to be conversive, and kids would be out playing, and just kind of like, man, I'm sick of this, I'm tired of this. And then one day I just kind of came to myself and said, you know what, I'm going to be the person that I want to be around. You know, and when I show up to the family, I'm going to be the one, I'm going to try to be the one that rolls up and says, hey, man, party's here because I rolled up. You know, or, you know, when leaving, I'm so sorry that the party's leaving with me, you know, but that's tension. And I'm going to take the party with me because I'm in control of that. I'm not in control of what my family members do. I'm not in control of what my children can do to a certain extent. That's right. I'm not in control of the circumstances of Christmas or traffic or drama, but I am in control of me. And I can decide I'm going to be what I want to be around. If I go to somebody's house and everybody's being, you know, bah humbug or there's family drama, then I'm going to try to do the best I can to just let it go for the day and be the one that everybody says, man, I want to be like that. I want to have a good time. I want to have a Christmas. And just to do what I want people to do to me to do to everybody else. I think that's one of the best ways to cope with sharing families with multiple families, sharing holidays with multiple families. Because there's so many things beyond your control, and like Teresa said, you can spend the whole day upset about that and miss the whole reason you're there doing that.
Yeah. One of the things I learned on that, Luke, is to remove expectation.
Yeah.
If you remove expectation, then you're not let down. Yeah. If you're not running and saying, oh my God, I hope they get me the iWatch, and then you open up a box, and it's nothing like that, and you have your head down, and you're rolling, and you're mad at everybody for not getting you what you want, you change your attitude and your expectation level. It doesn't matter. The watch doesn't matter. The gift doesn't matter. What matters is this, and what matters is this, and what matters is this. And that's the expectation that has to be removed, because the world will hammer you with expectation. They will pound you to the stakes with expectation. Family members will demand it from you. People will bleed it out of you, drain it out of you. But you're, like Pastor Luke said, you're in control of your own personal space. So remove the expectation. If they didn't give your kids gifts, it's okay. I'll get them gifts. If they didn't give us what we wanted, it's okay. God will give us what we need. Yeah. And that's what God wants from us. And that's that removing expectation. Help me up, because I grew up with really nothing.
Yeah.
And so this expectation of not having was kind of a vacancy that I had to get actually healed from. So this is where God comes in and makes that pleasant and you livable with others. Or else you're going to be crabby, mean, and nobody wants you around. And they're going to say, take your party and get out of here. And that's what we don't want. So removing the expectation has helped me.
Or I would say, I actually had that in my notes. You know, oftentimes, like you're saying, remove that. Sometimes you're not in control of being able to remove that.
Right. Yeah.
But one thing I have found is that you just have to come to the realization that if you communicate it clearly, this is what our plan is. Or if you don't have a plan or want to make a plan, communicate clearly what the expectation should be.
Right.
I mean, for example, you know, my family, my mom and Pastor Jess and Pastor Dan and all that, they all have a set time of which they eat dinner. And Stacy's family all has a set time in which they eat dinner. Just so happens that set time correlates or overlaps.
I didn't ever know that.
And so one of the things that we've had to do is just kind of say, listen, like, I may not be able to remove that expectation on my life, but I can communicate clearly to you that, listen, if we're not here, just eat without us. And this is the reality of what sharing Christmas is that if you try, because this is one of the things that expectation's talking about. Okay, the plan is you better be here at 4 o'clock. Well, then what you're not in control of is that your kids are having such a great time at such and such house over here that you're trying to rip them out of their good time to go somewhere else to be there on time, and the plan is spoiled. But if you say, you know what, here's the deal. We're going to try to make it around this time. If we can make it around this time, we're good. If we don't make it by such and such time, y'all just need to have a good night and eat your dinner, and we'll show up for dessert, or we'll save us a plate. You know, I like the ham, or my dad makes spaghetti, so it's always like, hey, listen, save some spaghetti sauce for us. If we don't eat it with you, we'll eat it afterwards anyways. And that way, there's a clear communication. So when somebody gets offended or hurt, you can help to, like my dad always taught me, overcome the objection before it becomes an objection. You didn't show up on this day, or you didn't show up on time. My expectation clearly was communicated to you that I'm going to do the best I can, but if I can't, you move on without us, and we'll all be together at some point in the day and have a good time. The expectation is we're going to spend some time together, whether it's around a dinner table or together, should be irrelevant if we communicate clearly what everybody's expectation should be.
Mom always says this, no expectations, no disappointments. And so if you have like this, especially for us women, we like paint these beautiful pictures of how it should be. Have we ever done that? And then all of a sudden you're like, that was nothing like I planned. And, you know, for me on Thanksgiving, I'm like, we're going to have everyone over for Thanksgiving and we're going to cook and it's going to be so fun. By the end of the day, I was like, bye, get out. I'm tired, and the dishes are still dirty. Like, I was fried. And honestly, it's because in my mind, I thought, we're going to cook, and then we're going to play games. We're going to go play football outside. None of that stuff happened. You know what I did? I cooked and I cleaned, and that's all I did. And so I felt like, man, I miss my kids. I didn't get to see my kids today. How was your day, kids? Did you have fun? Like, I don't even know where you were. So, you see, you have to really honestly think about, okay, am I making this too big where I'm missing out on family time? Am I, you know, honestly, look, I never knew that it was all at the same time. You should have told me. I would have, like, put in a good word for you. But honestly, like... I got your back, bro. Okay, so we can make adjustments in our lives, you know? And so if you're a grandparent in this room and you now have, like, a Luke with somebody, Luke needs to get his own traditions with his own family, right? He's going to have to eventually say, sorry, mornings are for us. And I don't care what family wants what. This is our time or whatever your thing is going to be. Because I know Dan and I had to at one point finally do that. We had to say, we're not going anywhere until 11 o'clock. That is our time with our kids. This is how it's going to be. Sorry, too bad. Because our kids started to go, well, when do we get to come home and open our presents? And it was like we really didn't know when. And then they never got to see their presents. They would, like, open them and we'd, like, run out the door. You know, and it was crazy. So just remember, as grandparents, I know it's got to be hard. I can't even imagine moving on and allowing your children to have their own times when they were part of your world. But... as grandparents, any tips or you're a grandma now and you had to make this adjustment. Was that hard for you, Dr. V? I mean, let's talk about it. I mean, that's hard for families, you know, that we're so close. And
it was extremely hard.
What were some tips that you could give moms that are going through that? Or dads?
I just say, you know, just it's hard to see your child grow up and start their own family. And, you know, it's hard for change. You always want it to be the same. And with me, I found it particularly hard because I have two young kids that wanted their brother around, wanted the whole family together, and I wanted it to be the same for them that it was for my older ones. So I kept trying to keep things a certain way so they would have the same experience, and I know it became very stressful for Jared and everything, and I don't know, and then emotions get involved. I was a basket case, to tell you the truth. It was just really, really difficult. And then I just had to go in prayer to God and say, okay, this is what I want for him. I want him to be happy. I want him this. I don't want to be this big old obstacle in the road. So you help me to fix it and help me to have the heart to change. And I know I can do this and everything. And this worked best. The first year I know we tried the splitting of the things. And I was like, well, why don't you go there first and then come to us, because I'm thinking you can stay longer and we can play games and whatever. Well, it was absolutely miserable because we usually have Christmas breakfast and they weren't there. And so I'm trying to wash dishes and do everything and not cry. I'm like, God, I really miss them. And the kids are like, well, where are they coming? And it was terrible. And then they were a little late and then there wasn't that much time. And I just like, that was just terrible, you know. So I'm like, this will never happen again. And after I went to prayer, I decided I could be big enough to change the date. And I'm much happier because the whole day the family is together, and it's the day that we all remember what Christ did for us, and we give gifts of love on that day. So for me, that's why it worked, because I'm not a good sharer.
Yeah. No, and not many people are good sharers. I think I'm going to have a hard time when my kids grow up, you know? Like, that's a hard thing to kind of let go of, and so... And it's not that they're a bad parent for wanting to hold on. You're not. And I think the kids feel it. I know we felt it. I know that Luke feels it. I know probably Jared felt it. Yeah. They love their families. And, you know, you always hear, like, oh, they have to go with the wife's family. That is not true. If you have a close family, parents are parents. And, you know, just as Pastor Jim and Deborah are Luke's parents, same with Dan. Dan loves his parents. And in fact, we're having family, you know, Christmas with them on Christmas Eve so that we can have a day with them as well. And I actually push for that as the in-law. So if you are a good wife, you will make time for your husband's family, because your husband's family needs love just as much as you do. And something we've talked about in women's ministry, so I'm going to pull it out here, is remember that your children need both sides of the family. Your children need to have a relationship if you have healthy homes, obviously. If they're crazy,
nutso people, and you need to, like, you know, have boundaries and do what you need to do. But if they're healthy families, the grandchildren need to have a relationship with both sides because that's where they came from, and it's a beautiful thing to create a beautiful atmosphere for the grandchildren. And so remember this, you're not in competition with each other on different sides. You just have to accommodate each other, and let's make it easy for each other. Stay in love, stay in unity, and stay in faith this Christmas season. And I believe that if we put that into a stamp, and if we have to change our molds and our ways of doing things, life is constantly changing. Life is constantly moving. And women, when we get our hearts hurt because things have to change, if your husband is around, Joelle, this would be your peace. This would be comforting us in that time of, Guy, you know, I'm sad the kids aren't going to be here at this time, and the wife would need the husband at that point. And so this is where we become a family, and then support your child because they're already feeling bad. So if you could say it's totally okay, we're fine with it, well, let's see, what do we need to move around next year? Make it easy for your families, you guys, so that, you know what, it's less stress on you and it's less stress on them. And let's just stay in love, stay in unity, and stay in faith together. So thank you guys for being candid with that.
Touch on something. You know, I was just thinking, we have to remember to be generous. And this applies whether you're single or married. When you have something, open your home. See the people who are around you in your world who don't have a place. Yeah. And what better time to say, you know what? Maybe you only have 10 seats around your table and it's all perfect, but can't you fit an 11th in there and a 12th? Yeah. You know, and maybe it has to become less and less perfect so that you can have more and more people, but actually it's more and more perfect. Because you're giving out the love of God. And, you know, the Word of God tells us that the generous man will be made rich, right? And he who waters others will himself be watered. So, I mean, even from a single perspective, I have my brother-in-law's family coming, you know, in-laws coming, friends coming. And it's like you don't already have a big connected family. Hey, come be a part of ours. So maybe that means the tables are filled, people are sitting on the couches, everybody's got a plate in their hand, but they're having a great time and they're connecting. So let's remember to be generous with those in our world when we become aware that they don't have somewhere to go.
Yes. And let me just say this. If you go to someone's house, help them. Because that really does help them.
Amen.
Yeah, that, I was going to say that. I mean, there is a lost art of hospitality.
It's true.
And the lost art of
it's
serving.
It's lost.
And the lost, hey, let me serve you a cup of coffee. What do you need? Sit down. Here's my chair. Here's my plate. I don't have to be served first. Hey, please, you're welcome. That lost art of hospitality, which I grew up with, which I don't see much today, pizza's over there, chicken's over there, toys over there, I'm over here, is not hospitality. Engage in hospitality. What's hospitality? Love, service, kindness, generous. What Pastor Luke says, whatever you want, you know, of others, has to be of you. We live in a culture that's selfish, and that selfish culture will bleed inside of you or come out of you if you're not serving like Jesus. And serving like Jesus means you don't have to have everything rolled out for them. Just be considerate and just be nice.
What would you say to the younger generation that doesn't know, okay, like a tip, okay? So, for instance, I know my mom taught me when you go to someone's house, bring something. You always bring something. Whether that be you bring flowers or you bring a dish, you ask if you can bring something. So the people that did come to our house, they brought something this year, and that was lovely. You
right.
know, so what is it that maybe you could give a tip that
okay,
maybe
well,
we don't know?
You said something key that would fly over people's heads if you're not paying attention. My mom taught me. My mom taught me, my dad taught me, is quickly disseminating from our culture. So that's why I believe in mentorship. If you have an open seat, invite somebody in. If they're not connected to family, they're your family. Be generous to them so then they could be a part of what a family, what godliness is and what wholeness is. Invite them in. So then you can coach them. We could say, hey, this is the way we do things. We don't have to do I don't say set spoons here and forks here and no one touch the china. We don't do that. But here's what we do do. You're welcome at my house. You know, you're welcome at my house. And you could use whatever you want, and you're a part of our family. For this time, for this moment, you're a part of what we do. So inviting. The young generation could learn a lot from the older generation. The older generation know how to do this. The older generation, this is in them. You'll see the first ones giving up their seat, welcoming people, serving coffee, whatever it is. I mean, my family criticizes me because I jump to the coffee pot and start making coffee for everybody. Well, that's an automatic response that's ingrained in me. Now, what the next generation could help yourself with is you kill them with kindness. You help them now doing what they need to be, become, because they don't know what that world is. The intact families that we grew up are no longer around. The family that's divided or the divorced families are now becoming more prevalent. So your expectation of what a wholesome home is found here. To get it inside of you so you could transfer it and say, look, we're doing life the way God is calling us to do it. So all we want is no presence. We just want your presence. Yeah. And you're welcome at my table and let's break bread. Amen. That's the expectation.
Teresa, if you could give one tip for the holiday season, something that has like made it awesome for y'all, just like popcorn answers, okay? What would you give for this holiday season? You could think about it if you want. Maybe we should go to somebody else. You're not on it, girl. You know, come on. All right. Luke, one tip for the holiday season that you love about Christmas and that you would give to other people.
Make the best of it.
It's good.
You know, you think about it like vacations. I was listening to a totally kind of a rabbit trail, but I was listening to a guy who was given like one of those TED Talks, and this was a guy that what he does for a living is he does extreme long-distance treks where he'll like circle the United States with just on foot and stuff like that. And so he's out like on his feet for 6 months. And he was talking about the types of fun. And he says like the class one fun is like, it's fun to do and it's fun to talk about. And he said like there's class two fun that's, it's not fun to do, but then it's fun to talk about. And he was talking about different things. And oftentimes what happens is when you have like a picture perfect holiday, it disappears into obscurity because there was nothing really very memorable about it other than the fact that it happened the way you wanted it to. But when you have a crazy moment, and when, like, the turkey, like, what is that movie where he cuts open the turkey and it just, like, right? A Christmas Story, right? Like, those type of moments that when everything goes sideways, those are the ones that at the moment they're the worst thing that could happen on a day. And everybody's crying and it's the worst thing that could happen. But you know what? Like, 2 or 3 years down the road when you're talking about it, the Christmas, at the Christmas table, somebody's going to laugh and be like, you remember that time that... Do you remember when Uncle So-and-so said that, or whatever it might be? And so just to make a conscientious choice to say, you know what? It's not going to go the way you want it to go. Like my wife, some people have been talking about it. It's like all the buzz because my wife's white, and she made tamales. And
oh, Stacy.
Yeah, she's got Mexican in her somewhere. But like the first batch went sideways. I mean, it was a wreck. But like coming back now and talking about it, it's a fun thing to laugh about and to enjoy. And when you can have that kind of lightheartedness, like, you know what, man, if it goes awry, if the dinner was terrible, if my green beans didn't come out, or you know what, so-and-so said what I thought that they would say, make the best of it. Because, you know, there's a lot of people in the Inland Empire and around the world that this is their first Christmas without somebody, you know, or this is their last Christmas with somebody. And we don't know. And, you know, we can try to strive to make everything the best you possibly can and then lose exactly what you're there for. And just make the best of it, you know, the drama, the tension, make the best of it. Be the person that you want to be around. That's all I could say for Christmas.
Good. Very good. What about you, Dr. B?
I was listening while Pastor Luke was talking, and I would just go with just be grateful for what you have. You know, I never stress at Christmas because I'm not one to have everything perfect or whatever. We just kind of like do it, you know. And you know, as you get older, you see you just care less and less what people think. I don't know how come that's so, but that's true. So I don't stress. But this year I was kind of stressed because we're remodeling, and it just made such a difference that I don't have a home. I don't have a home to decorate. We didn't put up a tree. And I was like really feeling it, you know. And I just really just started thinking, you know, had to do a Teresa, like, what do I have? What do I have to be grateful for? I'm missing the whole point, you know, because Pastor Deborah for years has ingrained in us, you make the home, you put in Christmas, you decorate, you do this. And I was just like, I have nothing to decorate, you know.
Light a candle.
Yeah, no. But what I realized is that I just really, you know, it became the best Christmas because I started thinking about, you know, my parents are alive and they're going to be there. And, you know, I have a new grandbaby and the people that I care about are still there. So it's not so much about how the home is decorated or whether I have a kitchen, which I haven't had for 4 months. It's not so much about that. Even though I have to go to Menifee to cook and bring it back to refrigerate and bring it back to Menifee because I don't have, it's been a mess, but it's about the people. So be grateful for what you have. Think about who's in your life, who's God, who God has blessed you with, and just be grateful.
I would say celebrate good things. When people come over, don't say, hey, uncle, I heard you fell off the wagon. You're a mess. Celebrate good things. Celebrate the good things. Celebrate the home run. My daughter just graduated from the university. It's a good thing. Woo-hoo! It's a big deal. These are the things we celebrate. The home runs, whatever they are, small, big, whatever it is. Celebrate positive expectation of good things. You know, God came to us and he brought a great gift. It was good, great tidings with great joy. That's what we need, the expectation of good things. So bring your family good things. Forget the negative. Turn that off. It doesn't matter. You know, just pipe it down. And if someone's getting negative, you know what? This is a positive filled zone area, and we're just talking about good things. So if you didn't get what you wanted, it's okay because I'm going to take it away from you and give it to somebody else, like my grandma used to tell me. But that's the way it was. Just celebrate the goodness of Jesus and celebrate the goodness inside of you and others and watch what God does with that event.
Good. Reverend Teresa.
Yeah, I'm ready. Took a minute. I would say take the initiative. You know, take the initiative. We talked about the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Invite people, open your home, be the one to smile, be the one to serve, be the one to open the doors. Don't wait for other people to do it to you. Because, you know, that's when we talked about expectation. We have expectations of others, but the difference between our reality and our expectation is our level of frustration, right? But if we begin to just take the initiative, then we believe God's the one that is going to pay us back, so to speak, right? God's the one that takes care of us. And we don't have to live with expectation. We can live with expectancy because everything we give out, God takes care of us, right? Our expectancy comes from him, and we don't have to live with frustration of the expectations we place on other people. So take the initiative. Go first.
It's awesome. Hey, did you guys enjoy the panel tonight? We could have gone all night. I was sitting there like, man, this is good stuff. So thank you, guys. You guys can go and have a seat at this time. Can we just give the Lord a praise for what we heard tonight? Just awesome, awesome, awesome. I love doing stuff like that. It's always fun. Maybe we'll do one in February during the marriage series or something like that. We'll figure it out and announce that when we do that, so that way you guys can be involved in that. I want to just take a couple quick moments before we dismiss and make sure that everybody's heart and life is right with Jesus. Before you leave this place, it'd be a tragedy if we came into the house of God and had such a good time, and then we let you go, and your heart wasn't right with God, and you died, and you ended up in hell and didn't go to heaven. Hell is a very real place. The Bible talks about it, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about hell. But guess what? Heaven's also a real place. And God sent Jesus to the earth. We celebrated at Christmas time. But there was a purpose and a reason that he sent Jesus, and that was to live the perfect, spotless, sinless life. To go to a cross and die in our place. And that all who looked to him on that cross would not have to go to hell. But because of our faith in him and because he died and he was raised again, now we can be raised again to life with him. And so we don't have to go to hell. God, that's why Jesus came, was to seek and save that which was lost. Some of you in this place tonight, I love you enough to tell you the truth, you're lost and you're not going to make it. You say, Pastor, how am I lost? I've been a good person. I was raised in church. You know, I've helped out and been involved in charities. I've gotten involved in church. I've volunteered. I was born in America. America's a Christian nation. My parents told me you were Christians growing up. I've always thought of myself as a Christian. I know about God, and I could quote the scripture. And you know, I really believe that I'm a Christian headed for heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're good or because you help out, or because you, give me your attention, the devil's trying to distract you right now, or because you get involved in charities, or because you're raised in a Christian home, or because you attend a church. Isn't that shocking? We think, all I got to do is go to church. No, nowhere in the Bible says just go to church and that makes you a Christian. So a lot of people who sit in church services and call themselves Christians and they're not going to make it. That's like me saying I can go to my garage, call myself a car, and that makes me a car. No, doesn't happen that way. Let's make sure in your life that you're going to get there the right way. The right way is God's way. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. I know. Our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it through the coals, made it out to be something that it's not. Here's what it simply means. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he talking about, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So in a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to get right with God. Get your heart right with God so that you can head for heaven and deny your presence in hell. Here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. Now I'm going to pop my hand on this microphone. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hand popping on that microphone just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's push past that tonight. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. A moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. Yet the devil thinks you're stupid, so he's trying to talk you out of it right now. This is just emotionalism. This is just fanaticism. He's putting you on the spot. He's trying to trick you. You don't have to do this. You're fine. You prayed a prayer a long time ago, but listen, even if you did pray a prayer a long time ago, did you follow it up with all of your heart and all of your life? Because if not, I love you enough to tell you the truth. Magical abracadabra words don't work when it comes to your salvation. You need to, yes, receive the Lord through prayer, but then you got to follow it up with all your heart and all of your life. Maybe one time you're serving the Lord, you backslid, and tonight it's your time to come home. Whatever it is, tonight you know where you're at with God. You know the response that you need to give right now. That's all of your heart and all of your life. Tonight is your night of salvation. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. You say, Pastor, I've got time. Listen, I bet you the people that woke up on December 2nd, went to work, didn't expect that that was going to be their last day on the earth. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. Tonight, you're being presented with an opportunity. You say, all roads lead to heaven. No, nowhere in the Bible say all roads lead to heaven any more than all roads on the earth lead to the moon. Come on, we got to get there God's way. You must be born again. Tonight, will you give him all of your heart, all of your life? I'm going to count to three, pop my hand on this microphone. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. If you're watching out there in the foyer, if you're watching online, hey, get ready, get your hand up. God sees, God's watching. If you're on campus, you can come into the church service or tell an usher. If you're online watching, then right after you raise your hand, then I want you to minimize the video browser, click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and go to the tab that says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, come on. Front to back, left to right. Come on, get ready to get your hand up. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one. There's two. There's three. God bless you. Who else? There's four. Got you right there. Five, six. Thank you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Thank you, guys. I got you right over there. Thank you. I got you right there. Thank you. God bless you, guys. Got you. All right, if I did not already see your hand, come on, raise it up high. If you say, I don't know if you really counted me, or I don't know if you saw me, just raise it up high for me right now. There's six wise people already. Where are you at? Number seven. That's you. Just raise up your hand high when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Anybody else? Six wise people already. Didn't embarrass them and won't embarrass you. Begging the family, is there anybody? Give me a wave if I don't see you already. Is there anybody else? Anybody on this side? Need to give God all your heart, need to give God all your life. Anybody else, real quick? I'm going to wrap this thing up. Come on, if you want to be included in this, get your hand up right now. You know it's you. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a hand for six wise people. Hallelujah. All right, quickly, all six of you, here's what I want you to do. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get your stuff, in other words, get a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. Let's all stand and welcome them. You come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Let's give him a hand. You can come too.
In you. Jesus, I belong.
If your children raise their hand, come on, bring them. They'll remember this.
You're the reason that I live.
Anybody else?
You're the reason that I breathe.
Come on, nudge your neighbor. Say, come on, friend,
Jesus,
I'll go with you.
I believe in you. Jesus, I belong.
Hallelujah. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make it right to the front. Hallelujah. Well, you guys came. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad that you guys are here. So excited for your new life. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine. See this guy waving at you right over here? Remember him? Pastor Joel. He was just up here talking, all right? He's going to do three things with you guys, all right? I'm going to let you know what they are. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then finally, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Let me describe it to you like this. It's a friend, someone who goes to this church, who will be a friend to you, encourage you in the ways of God, so you don't go back to your old ways, don't go back serving the devil. You go on with the new ways with God, okay? He'll describe how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? You guys will make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.